Hey folks, before we get started, I just wanted to say that this video was made possible by my supporters on Patreon. You can skip to this timestamp if you don't want to listen to this, by the way. But I could not do what I do without their help, or at least I wouldn't be able to put in the time needed to make these videos the way I want to. Last year, at the start of the KH2 boss ranking, I announced a Patreon stretch goal. 100 patrons in exchange for a video where I watch and review all of the direct-to-video Disney sequels. People so generously helped me reach that goal, and it resulted in one of my favorite videos I've done on the channel. I have already promised to do a video dedicated to Kingdom Hearts 358 over 2 days when I hit 150 patrons, but I also want to sweeten the deal. Some people were disappointed to see that some films weren't included in that sequel video due to my criteria, so I want to make it up to them. In addition to a day's video, if or when I hit 150 Patreon supporters, I will make a sequel to the sequel video. Every Winnie the Pooh or Tinkerbell movie I can get my hands on, Return to Neverland, Jungle Book 2, all of it. The amount pledged doesn't matter, just the number of people. So if you enjoy the vid today, or if either of those projects sound interesting to you, I humbly ask you to consider checking out my page at patreon.com/regularpat. Thus ends the panhandling portion of the video. Here comes the jingle portion. Well, here we are again. Longtime viewers of the channel may recall that in 2020 and 2021, I released videos around Christmas in which I ranked the bosses of Kingdom Hearts 1 and 2. And I don't want to work on Christmas this year, so the third installment is here a bit earlier. I had debated on whether the third video would be Birth by Sleep or 3, but I figured we can always loop back around to the side game, so don't rule those out for the future. Like with my rankings of the 1 and 2 bosses, this list is not based on any one metric. The actual gameplay a player experiences during a boss is definitely important here, but I also factor in other elements like design and story significance when I weigh how much I enjoy a boss, so you may find some easier and simpler bosses ranked higher than comparatively tougher ones. Because of this, like with KH2, I'm not going to cover the data battles from Remind in this video because while they're certainly the definitive version of many of the organization battles in the gameplay sense, they lack story significance. It's too messy of an exercise to determine if they'd all rank higher or lower than their campaign counterparts, not to mention too repetitive for one video, so I think a separate video on the data fights may be in order somewhere down the line. I actually intended to do that for KH2's data fights at some point this year, but got distracted by other projects, so we'll see about both this and that video getting a follow-up eventually. Before the list proper, I just had some general thoughts to share. If you just want to get to the list, you can skip to this timestamp, though you might find yourself lacking some context for some of my choices without my typical regular Pat preamble, because you'll find that these ranking videos are actually essays in disguise. So again, frequent viewers of the channel already know this, but if you're new, KH3 is my second favorite game in the franchise after KH1. I can direct you to a catalog of old videos to explain why I never said the number 2 in that last sentence. Despite this, however, I found that this project lacked the obvious picks that felt more commonplace in my rankings for both KH1 and 2. Before I even started writing the script for those videos or gathering footage of the bosses, I kind of already knew what would be at the top of the list, but nothing really sprang to mind immediately for KH3. And to be honest, even after playing through the game for this project, I found myself somewhat underwhelmed, at least as far as bosses were concerned. There just didn't seem to be as many standout encounters as there were in the first two numbered titles. I arrived at a few possible explanations for this. First, KH3 is the newest game of the bunch. It has been out for nearly 4 years at this point, if you could believe it, but I wonder if it just hasn't had the time to mythologize itself in the way that 1 and 2 have. Not to mention, that process is probably a lot easier and more likely to happen when you first play something when you're 6 or 9 years old instead of 22. In tandem with that point, I think, is my opinion that KH3 is the easiest game of the numbered titles and possibly of the entire series. And by that I mean it's the easiest when you're playing through each game for the first time with no self-imposed challenges. You can go out of your way to make all of these games more difficult for yourself, which I have done several times. And I should say, a game's difficulty and its quality have no correlation for me. I think all three of the mainline games offer a good challenge at various points. But in the KH2 ranking, when I said I found its campaign to be easier than 1's, a few people took that as some sort of insult. And I've insulted KH2 several times on this channel, but not for that. My first time playing KH1, I found myself stuck on Guard Armor, Cerberus, Stealth Sneak, Pot Centipede, The Cave, Giant Ursula, Anti-Sora, Captain Hook, The Dragon, Riku 2, and Ansem 2. In KH2, my roadblocks were Demix, Zaldan, and Zigbar. In KH3, it was like the Scalaphites and Dark Baymax for some reason. Now, again, when you play these games at dramatically different points in your life, you're bound to find that you're overall better at video games when you play a title at a more advanced age. And like I said, even though I don't think difficulty and quality are inherently linked, I think getting stumped or struggling on a boss can definitely help build up that mythos, and that just doesn't happen as much in KH3. But I do wish a version of myself with a single-digit age could have played KH3 and given you his thoughts. Another factor at play here, I think, is that Sora has even more mobility and access to a big bag of tricks in this game much earlier than he does in KH2. Between flow motion, form changes, shot locking, air stepping, team moves, and attraction flow, Sora can just stack shit up to make much quicker work of bosses this go around. And to a degree, I do think this is a flaw. At the very least, I wish these abilities were a bit more gradually earned. I could see giving him half of that stuff at the very start just to immediately give the player some new mechanics to mess around with, but not all of it. On top of that, he'll still unlock magic spells, links, and crazy combos and reprisal abilities throughout the game. There's just so much in his kit, it often feels like the bosses don't stand a chance unless you're doing a critical or challenge run. I always enjoyed how Sora felt like an underdog in KH1, and while it makes sense from a story perspective that he would be much more powerful by KH3, I very rarely feel like any of these encounters can be taken seriously. And again, I'm old now, so that is no doubt playing a part. One of my major critiques of KH2 is that its worlds were stuck being flat and boring because while Sora could become extremely mobile, he also might not if the player doesn't level up their drive forms, and so the environments always have to accommodate a base level Sora. KH3's worlds got the memo this time, but its bosses are struggling to keep up, at least on more casual playthroughs. The last major factor is the dramatic scaling back of one-time gimmicks in KH3 boss fights. While I did find that KH2 at times felt a bit oversaturated with these special meters or counters, they did at least help distinguish a battle and help them feel a bit more memorable. Some I found pointless, like Steamboat Pete's, some sort of middling like Hostile Programs or Sean Yu's, and some kind of interesting or complementary to the fight, like the Grim Reapers. At the very least, those gimmicks added something to separate those fights from the rest, for better or worse. KH3's fights are much more direct like KH1's, but I think since Sora is just so powerful in this game, the bosses could have used a little edge by giving them an extra tool to force the player to engage on the boss's terms. And some KH3 fights do have these, but they're much less common. Alright, 1300 words later, I think we can start the video now.
Let's do this!
So, obviously, it's the first entry on the list, let's just get Genie Jafar out of the way. In KH3, Genie Jafar takes on the form of... a... giant fish? Wait, what, you mean there's... there's no... But I always put Genie Jafar last. It's like a family tradition. I guess this is what Elsa meant about letting go. Well, in last place is Big Fish. Its real name is the Lightning Angler, but you and I know it as Big Fish, because it is, bar none, the most forgettable heartless boss across the numbered titles. Sora, dumbassedly, opens this conspicuous chest that provokes the rage of Larxene's unloved pet Goldfish, the player falls into a coma for a few minutes, and wakes up with the aerial Heartbinder. I think the only truly memorable thing about this encounter is that it's one of two underwater boss fights, though I wouldn't say I hate it for that. The underwater controls have been massively improved since 1, and especially since 2, so I can't even say I like this less than Genie Jafar, but I'm definitely less passionate about it. There may be worse bosses in this game on a gameplay level, but when this boss's gameplay leaves me whelmed at best, combined with the truth that I have clearer memories of my first birthday than any time I fought this wet nothing, it was always kind of a lock for last place for me. The KH1 track Squirming Evil also plays for this battle, which I actively dislike. I'm all for hearing the classics, but that song exclusively played for Disney bosses in KH1, and this is the one outlier usage of the song, and I hate that. If they really wanted to use this track somewhere, I'd slap it on Marshmallow or One of the Titans and give this one Shrouding Dark Cloud. We can't forget our roots, but we can and will forget the big fish.
Water!
Speaking of our roots, how dare you show your face here again? Listen, I'm all for tradition and bookends, but I can only beat the shit out of something so many times without starting to feel kinda bad. It just feels kind of passé to still be bludgeoning Darksides in 2019 and beyond. So at 35 and 34, I have the Remind Scala Darkside and the Tutorial Final World Darkside in that order. I'm lower on the Remind appearance because I'm mostly just insulted by the audacity of this bedhead bastard to show up for the fifth time if you're only counting the time Sora had to fight him. Six if you count Data Sora, but you don't have to. This might be a hate crime, but if I found Data Sora on my computer, I would drag and drop him into the recycle bin, right-click on the recycle bin, and then empty the recycle bin. Anyway, I legitimately could not believe that I had to fight a Darkseid in Remind. It's probably the low point of an otherwise great DLC, but this is just so boring. Like, as far as I can discern, the only difference is that he's wearing the Kairi perfume and has more health, but otherwise he doesn't do anything new or interesting. Even the Forest of Thorns Darkseid in 0.2 had some new moves, but this one is basically plucked right out of 2002. I can appreciate the bookends of fighting a dark side at the start of KH1 and fighting one again at the end of KH3, but it really is just a punching bag. I want to see this fucker use those wings on his back. I put the tutorial dark side one spot above the Scala one because nostalgia was running a lot higher for the first encounter, and I think his watery design is neat. Fittingly though, its intimidation factor has been watered down quite a bit in the 17-year interim since Sora last fought it. If this big ugly bitch in the KH4 trailer is the first boss of that game, it at least looks dark side adjacent, so hopefully it'll bring back some honor to the family name.
You're outta here!
Next is an enemy that I wasn't even sure if I should count as a boss. It's the Chaos Carriage. The game sort of treats it as one, and the list is already shorter than both the KH1 and 2 rankings, so I figured I may as well throw it in. I guess it's more like a mini-boss, and that's as in a more minor encounter and not Mickey's girlfriend wearing a pantsuit. Not all jokes and bits can be winners, they can't all be Clayton shooting him in the fucking face. Speaking of our dearly departed gorilla researcher, the Carriage is both accompanied by and momentarily piloted by Power Wilds, who fled to the Kingdom of COVID and Twilight Town after Edgar Rice Burroughs snapped his fingers. What the fuck is my job? For the first half of the encounter, you have to get rid of all the monkeys, which reminds me of how I deal with NFT accounts on Twitter. At the time of writing this, I don't know what's going to happen to Twitter, so I'll have to come back to this part later and edit this sentence. And this part is in red and bold and says, "Seriously, don't forget to come back to this part before we record." Anyway, once the ape part of the battle is over, the board part begins. The Chaos Carriage, while chaos and also indeed carriage, takes entirely too long to beat even on the easiest difficulties. It's not about the length of the HP bar, it's about how you use it, and the CC mainly just charges around and does generic spinning moves, so I am left unimpressed. This is worsened by the fact that you're essentially forced to deplete its HP 3 times before you can successfully send this thing on its way to the glue factory. At least you get to fight a boss with Rapunzel and Flynn in the party since they're both so busy during Grim Guardian as crying and dying or whatever, fucking babies.
Giddy up!
Guess we'll get another pseudo-boss out of the way. It's the Kraken, also known by his formal, god-given full name.
Me neck, me back, me pussy and me Kraken.
You might consider this as more of an event than a boss battle, but who are we to judge the Kraken's occupational status? It's got a big health bar, it's got special music, and again, this list is shorter, so let's talk crack. The fight against Ursula's alcoholic stepfather isn't the mechanically deepest ocean in the Seven Seas, but it's at least more memorable than fellow aquatic boss, Big Fish. You do have to babysit the Black Pearl, which the Kraken is doing an adult anime with, or whatever Vexen calls that stuff he watches on his laptop. Some enemy ships will pop up occasionally, but Sora will gleefully send them to hell with a well-placed shot, and you can get back to eviscerating the Kraken's health bar with the Raging Cannons command, which is extremely satisfying. The Kraken itself doesn't really do anything besides hold onto its ship for dear life, which again reminds me of a lot of Kingdom Hearts Twitter accounts. Also, the first time playing this fight, I had an unfortunate glitch where I reduced the Kraken's HP to 0, the screen faded to white, and then I heard the failure sound and was greeted by Sora doing his foldy arms pose. Then I had to do the whole thing over again, so I'm still a little bitter about that.
Cannons!
At 31, we have another familiar 0.2 face, or many, many faces. It's the Demon Tower. And you know what? I'm out on the Demon Tower too. It's this high because you get to fight it twice as Riku, and that's a fun shakeup in the base game, though I don't really like the feel of how he controls too much. But I'm just not impressed by shadows standing on each other's shoulders so they can appear taller and get into an R-rated movie. Demon is a stretch. These are the Goombas of the Kingdom Hearts world cosplaying as the Smorg from Paper Mario The Thousand Year Door. I get strength in numbers, but I don't know, I just don't buy it. Maybe shadows are just a lot more intimidating to the characters in game, like Sora loses his fucking mind when he sees a fake one in Hero's Garage, even though he's effortlessly slaughtered thousands of them in the past 2 years. So I tend to find these demon collectives a bit underwhelming, but I've got the tower this high for the chance to play as Riku, as well as access to a neat team RC with Mickey. The second fight, of course, lets the player execute the most powerful reaction command in KH history. This button lets you switch to a character who doesn't have his cure spell mapped to triangle like a fucking psychopath. I will never forgive Riku for this. I would definitely put the second battle higher for the occasional anti-Aqua appearance, but even she can't really be arsed to stick around for more than a few seconds. I think she's off somewhere trying to get a quick meal in before her big boss fight, notices the Mook Tower getting clobbered, teleports in, throws out some attacks, and then pieces out. Now, if we're ranking the KH3 bosses by how good they'd be at running a barbershop, the Demon Tower would be in first place. Grim Guardianess would be last.
Not good!
When I picked up KH3 on release day, I started my first file on Proud mode. As much as I wanted to get through the game quickly to find out what happens, I wanted a challenge, and Proud was the highest difficulty available at launch. I did have a decent amount of deaths, mostly on mob fights actually, and for the first handful of worlds, the only boss I died on was Davy Jones, and I beat him on my second try. But for whatever reason, I get to San Francisco and I die to the fucking edgy Stay Puft Marshmallow Man 4 times. Granted, most of my trouble can probably be attributed to the change-up in controls. But some of it surely came from the fact that I wasted a ton of my time trying to punch him instead of staying as far away from him as possible and shooting at him from a distance like a little baby-back Baymax bitch. The fight is this high on the list because Disney bosses are so few and far between in KH3, even though this guy was invented for the game. And I mean, it's kinda neat to fight a dark version of a party member, like I would've loved to fight Goth Aladdin in KH1 or 2. Although, the drama of Dark Baymax never really grabbed me, Hiro was like so in his feelings about it, and if I'm the current Baymax, I'd be like, oh no, I guess I'll just go fuck myself. Like, I get that this one has the original Baymax's combat chip, but I don't know, it all kinda came off as forced sentimentality to me. I do at least enjoy the spectacle of flying through San Francisco for the first phase, I just didn't care for still being stuck on Baymax for the second half. I do have to admit that Dark Baymax's big evil wings are pretty sick though, it reminded me of Taboo from Super Smash Bros. Brawl. But overall, Dark Baymax is still my pick for the worst Disney boss in the game, brought forth by the worst organization member, go figure.
Baymax!
Let's just loop back around to another demon conglomerate. Surf's up, bro, it's the Demon Tide. Maybe I'm too low on this, but again, I felt some fatigue having to deal with this thing after already doing a much harder version of the fight as Aqua in 0.2. I get that it's a lot of Heartless, apparently enough to kill the entire cast of protagonists, but I, again, just have trouble buying it. I wish they were taken out by something else, whether it was a character or just some other enemy or collective of enemies that isn't a Goomba Hurricane. Though I guess we can count ourselves lucky we weren't forced to take on a tornado of large bodies or invisibles. For the record, I'm only counting the graveyard version of this fight for the purposes of the list, since the Twilight Town version doesn't actually make you deplete all its HP. But I might have that battle higher otherwise, since I tend to have more fun fighting in that kind of environment instead of a big dust bowl, though sometimes the tide can get caught on buildings and get you hit or killed unfairly. The fight itself isn't really bad though, it just boils down to if red, you're dead, so just back off until it stops glowing. The coolest attack is definitely the one that launches Sora into the air and he has to make his way back to the ground while dodging all of these incoming shadow boogers. Mind you, if I were factoring in the Light of the Past sequence with the Union Cross Keyblades, this battle would probably shoot up another 10 places, but I decided against it since it's hardly really a fight at that point. I have spoken about that whole part in my top 10 favorite scenes video from back in 2020 though. But yeah, the repetitive nature of this fight mixed with it having entirely too much health for what it has to offer has landed it this low. I did at least get a sick kill cam moment when I was getting footage. Donald is my ride or die for fucking life. At number 28 is the Catastrochorus, big dinosaur guy. I will say, this guy is dangerously close to Big Fish territory in terms of memorability, but avoids that tier thanks to its sheer size and how it King Kongs its way up to the top of a building for the second phase. I didn't even realize until now, but I have all these mid-world Heartless bosses pretty low on the list, so maybe the devs kept them from being the finale of these worlds for a reason. I don't think the dinosaur is a bad fight, but they did somehow, find a way to make it sort of boring and way too easy. Even on my critical level 1 stream, which featured me dying to anything from Dark Side to the Monstropolis lasers, I managed to get through Big Dino with no real issues. The Cattle Stracicast also has that thing where I can't tell if it's ugly or cute, it's kind of like my gut reaction when I see a newborn baby. It sort of has excited golden retriever energy, except it's also doing thousands of dollars in property damage, and sometimes it tuckers itself out and has to take a nap. Big Dino also unfortunately suffers from volcanic acne and a sentient wizard tail, which definitely is cute. Look at his stupid hands, what a little idiot. It's sort of fun to have something of a free roam battle in San Francisco, and I like how the Cattle Clorox destroys the terrain as he runs through it, but he goes extinct pretty quickly. I think the game knew it was a bit of a pushover because it recycles him again for a battle gate later on in the graveyard. Continuing the thread of mid-world Heartless bosses, we have the Raging Vulture. And I feel like this is probably a lot of people's chalk pick for one of, if not their absolute least favorite fight, and I won't pretend I don't understand why. I'm not so high on the boss itself, but more so the atmosphere. It's sort of reminiscent of the Steamboat Pete fight from KH2, but with a much more hectic and entertaining setup portion. The punchline is pretty much the same, grab onto something and beat on the target until you get shaken off. That part is definitely brain dead, and the window you have to use the barrier against the vulture's breath attack is almost insultingly generous. On standard, it's a bit too easy, and on critical level 1, it can feel borderline cruel at times, and regardless of difficulty, it's gonna take a good bit longer than most other bosses in the campaign. I feel like it can hit the difficulty sweet spot when you play on Proud though, and I remember having a lot of fun hopping from Heartless to Heartless and air-stepping and grinding on the fluffy and super edible-looking rainbow clouds. It can't be good for you, but it looks really appealing, sort of like trying to make a career on YouTube. Like a lot of these lower tier bosses, I think the experience would be a lot more enjoyable if this thing had like half the HP. I don't really need two cycles of gunning it down, it just starts to feel like it's overstaying its welcome. A lot of other Heartless bosses have less HP, but they need the extra health way more than the Vulture because of how quickly Sora can tear through them. And in the Vulture's case, Sora is put in this limited attack pool and has to pick away at Big Bird's HP for like 5 minutes, and when he does get in Keyblading range, it's pretty monotonous. This is also one of those rare KH3 fights that has some kind of gimmick bar, though it doesn't really add a ton. I don't think I've ever let the ship get too damaged even on higher difficulties. I also have to give the Vulture some credit for a pretty spooky design, and it leans into the pirate aesthetic a lot more than Big Fish does.
Make him fly!
At number 26, another big Heartless boss, the King of Toys. And again, maybe a bit of a misnomer. Prince or Archduke of Toys seems a bit more apt for this guy. I personally think the true King of Toys is this thing. This thing kicked ass. I kind of forget that the King of Toys apparently comes from the darkness that young Xehanort draws out of Buzz, and that darkness manifests as a big spaceship, which would be like if the darkness in my heart manifested as a hand-me-down Ford Escape. Though I'd rather fight this spaceship than the earlier UFO, fuck that thing. The King himself is not super interesting to me, his attacks are pretty easy to react to, and he doesn't do anything particularly flashy. He'll charge at you and sometimes say it's nerf or nothing, which is always an easy choice for Xemnas. I think the real highlight here is the environment, which is chock full of blocks and objects that react to what you and the boss do. So there are a lot of opportunities to use all the flying debris as cover or jumping off points to get on top of the King's head. Part of me wishes you could just air step up to his face, because sometimes you do end up stranded in a flat area with nothing to jump on, but these bosses go down so quickly, I kind of don't even mind having to court him somewhere else so you can more easily reach him. And the random nature of where everything ends up can hypothetically make for a different battle environment every single time you play. Plus, the visuals here are just really fun and evocative of Toy Story. I was hoping for more stuff like this as opposed to the bulk of the world, which was Galaxy Toys. You feel a lot more, well, toy-like during this fight, both thanks to the objects littering the arena and the more consistent sense of scale here. Also, I am only now realizing as I look at its render that it has a fake face on the front here. I never once paid attention to its little yellow mouth and eyes, I was always looking at the shrimpy little head up top.
It can't be.
No matter how cool this boss is or could have been, it will always be held far, far back by the fact that they're called Dark Cubes. Thanks a lot, Fred. Microbots would have been fine, though I guess they're technically heartless due to releasing a heart when killed. The Dark Cube's experience can really be broken up into three parts. The fake fight where you're a useless baby, the Big Hero 6 rescue portion, and the actual boss battle being ranked here. I have to say though, if I could, I'd rank the rescue part really high because I love when Kingdom Hearts makes me interact with the environment to solve problems. I'm a total slut for that shit, I'm a complete and utter whore for it. When KH1 asked me to cast Thunder on the wires in the 3rd district, I took my pants off. But alas, we're only looking at that third Dark Cubes part, which is overall fine. The battle shifts from distinct defensive phases where you have to block or dodge the Dark Cube's various transformations, and the offensive stages where it floats there uselessly as you wail on it. It's another pretty easy encounter, one that I was able to get through pretty handily even on critical level 1. And during either that type of run or the standard mode file I used to get footage, I was able to beat the Dark Cubes without seeing all of its major attacks. The thing just lets you obliterate its HP for such long stretches of time, it's kind of ridiculous. I did like its different attacks and transformations, though it left me wanting a bit more variety. It'll shoot at you, form a big hand to punch you, and turn into the Spore logo as a personal attack against me, who really wants Spore 2 but knows that if it did exist, it would still be made by EA, so what's the fucking point? Anyway, I also like playing around in the Dark Cubes on the floor, it's like an evil ball pit.
Yay!
Remember the world terminus in KH1? It was a nice, albeit spooky, walk down memory lane. Every world with a keyhole had a corresponding room in this segment and end of the world called the world terminus. And you don't actually have to fight all the mobs in each room to progress, you only need to clear the rooms from the worlds whose keyholes you haven't locked. So at most, you only need to clear 2 rooms before you can move on. I bring this up because KH3, for better or worse, does a bit of a callback to the world terminus by way of the Lich sequence, except we need to go back to every Disney world, and I think we're actually going back to the worlds themselves instead of what I assume were just projections of them, like in KH1. If that's the case, everyone is conveniently not around when Sora and the Lich tromp through, like Sully would have come in pretty clutch right about now. The Lich has a rad design, it's kind of like a cross between the Phantom and Grim Reaper, which, yeah, I wonder if they were kicking themselves for blowing that name on the KH2 boss, because functionally, this guy is the true Grim Reaper of Heartless. Which, I don't know if he's going rogue or what, because last I checked, Heartless are supposed to make more Heartless, and the Lich seems to be, like, collecting hearts or taking them somewhere. And does he only care about protagonist hearts? Because I don't remember him showing up to take Travis's or Clayton's hearts when they died. Regardless, Sora chases this hoarder by using the power of waking to fall through a black void, and he only has Jiminy to keep him company, so it's truly one of the scariest parts of the game. The Lich is this high because of the task we're being asked to accomplish. Like, Sora stealing back the hearts from the manifestation of death by breaking the laws of nature is metal as fuck. The battle, or rather seven battles, wear a bit thin though, and the final one isn't really even that much of a show. The Lich is just accompanied by some Neo Shadows. I do like how the Lich will adopt different attacks depending on what world you're fighting him in, which are often reflective of the world somehow, like a water move in the Caribbean or a blizzard move in Arendelle. On that note, has anyone else tried to work out why the Guardians end up in each world? Some of them seem intentional, like of course you put Aqua in the world covered in water, Mickey in Kingdom of COVID because he's a king, Ven in Toy Box because he's a little baby who still plays with toy swords.
That's cute.
I know Goofy is in Arendelle because he's a stone-cold killer. Does this look like the face of mercy to you? The Lich is not particularly difficult, save for the part where you might lose sight of him as he skips off into the Rona Marsh. In cutscenes, he flees from world to world, and in-game, his signature attack is running away, leaving behind harmful after-images, so points for consistency, I suppose.
Going somewhere?
At number 23 is the first appearance of one of the Titan battles, that being the Ice and Lava Titan duo. I guess Tornado Titan is there too, but he's literally a background character who can't be harmed. The real combatants here are the Titans Ice and Lava, whose favorite song is Hot and Cold by Katy Pericles. Now there's a fucking joke you're not gonna get anywhere else. Fred takes a lot of credit for inventing the ice and fire combo move, but these guys are the true pioneers of that technique in this game. I know I have the duo the lowest, but I still think it's a fun fight. I just think the fights on either end of this one have a bit more pizzazz to them. It's also nice to finally get to fight more than just the Rock or Ice Titan. I was wondering why it took Chill 3 for them to bother with any of the other ones from the movie. Thankfully, the Titans have erected a rock mound of a very convenient height, which allows Sora the opportunity to bludgeon their jowls. Maybe I have these guys too high since they sort of just lumber there and throw up on you, but I'm also fiending for the opportunity to fight literally anybody from a Disney movie, even though these two are like Z-listers. Ice Titan may have had the hardest fall for a boss in the entire series though, going from Super Boss in KH1, downgraded to a Colossus in BBS, and then a Tutorial World boss for KH3. And at least he could turn around a bit in those other games, but apparently Permafrost has set in on his feet this go around. The Tornado Titan spends the entire battle running interference, essentially just Chernobogging the party away whenever he pleases. He's kind of a prick for inserting himself into this one. He's gonna get his own fight in like 2 minutes where he gets to do something besides literally blow.
Are both of you ready?
I know people were disappointed with how the 100 Acre Wood was handled in KH3, but it did finish strong with a pretty solid boss fight in the Lump of Horror. He makes this grand entrance, he's captured Rue, and even Sora looks terrified. Then he forces you to play Candy Crush 3 times with a bunch of crops. It's truly cruel and unusual. Later on, he shows up again as the boss of Monstropolis in a second form, thankfully much easier to deal with this time. For this fight, he takes on the form of a muck evolution that Vanitas glued some batteries to. While the Lump lacks a fun environment like the King of Toys, it provides more of a challenge and just feels like it has more distinct moves and phases than a lot of the other Heartless bosses we've already talked about. Though I should clarify, this is an Unversed. They're like Heartless, but they're depressed. I never really got fully on board with the Unversed, like, as a concept they're fine. Design-wise, they never felt visually distinct enough from Heartless to justify their existence, and Lump is no real exception for me. You could slap the Heartless emblem on him and I wouldn't really bat an eye, but this is, lore-wise, not exactly an embodiment of darkness, but actually the physical manifestation of the negative energy found in screams of children, which I guess is poop with a frowny face. A cool detail though is that you can see the machinery parts that'll later make up the Lump's body as you're progressing through the factory way before you actually fight it. Part of me wants to rank Lump lower because I feel like it takes up the spot that could have gone to a perfectly good boss fight against Randall, who I always thought would be the most natural Disney villain fight in the game. But I'm ranking it for what it is, not what it isn't, and what it is pretty good. At bare minimum, I'm able to more clearly remember the attacks and components to this fight. It wasn't like a freeform beatdown, at least not the entire time. And maybe it's just more burned in my mind because it's something of a level 1 roadblock. I tend to think it's usually a positive when the boss enters some kind of invulnerable state that requires you to divert your strategy in a direction that isn't press X on it until the screen goes white. Sometimes that just means pressing X on another thing, like with these sticky hands that you can get from those little capsule toy machines for 50 cents, but it's something. This includes a DM-like phase where Lump will take you to Goo Hell, which gives me vivid flashbacks to my tour in Isle Delfino. Lump will linger in the middle here part of the stage, and the hands it shoots are annoying and a pain. It's Lump. It's Lump. It's Lump. It might be dead. That's the semi-obscure 90s music reference for this boss ranking.
Woo!
Next up, we have the fight against the blue-haired young woman who's normally friendly, if a bit wooden, but was possessed by the forces of darkness. See what I did? I baited you into possibly thinking it was one thing by using descriptions that also fit this other thing, and now I've switched it to reveal that it's about the thing you may not have expected because it's the less notorious of the two things. Angelic Amber, not Anti-Aqua. But you really have to wonder if it's intentional foreshadowing given the similarities. I mean, even their initials are the same. AA Angelic Amber, AA Anti-Aqua, and on level 1, this fight puts me on the path to AA. But enough of sounding like a repetitive Canadian. I always favored this toy box fight over the King of Toys, if only for how much creepier Amber is, and for being one of the few not-big monster bosses in the game, especially the early game. And, as usual, boss battles that take place in anything that's not a flat circular arena always do well with me. Amber's attacks are nothing crazy, she mostly just charges and spins around, but they can come out pretty quick. She's also joined by a bunch of Heartless, and as I alluded to, they can make the fight on level 1 especially painful. Your best bet is to try and isolate the battle to one part of the store, otherwise you'll end up getting a bunch of extra pillow pets involved. I know she's just like a bummed out Polly Pocket, but again, it feels more evocative of Toy Story than something like the King of Toys, despite the name. I can't really see that guy as a Toy Story character in the way I can see Amber being one. I guess this also goes for the bouncy pets and the robots and everything else, but why exactly is it that these toys don't talk, possessed or not? Are they not functionally born until purchase? The existential questions about Toy Story can go on forever, like is she conscious? All of this only adds to the creep factor of this encounter. Plus, we get a new arrangement of tension rising for this boss as a cherry on top. It's also always refreshing to see the pig be put in jail. Nice role reversal there. Heading back to the top of Mount Olympus for our first entry in the top 20, it's the Tornado Titan. I feel like this one might be hit or miss for some, since it's a bit unconventional for having you in midair for most of the fight, but goddamn did I think it was cool the first time I played KH3. Ignoring the fact that the Tornado Titan is made out of, like, tangible wind pieces that can somehow be hit, bit of a design flaw there, this fight is pure spectacle. You could consider the battle something of an airstep or freefall tutorial, since the fight really leans into those two new mechanics, but you can still very much fuck it up and find yourself with a face full of Doric Pillar. I also don't really mind a fight where I'm airborne, and let me clarify, airborne, but not attached to a carpet or healthcare companion. Sora's limited to his aerial kit for most of the battle, but I find myself using air combos more often anyway, so it never really felt like I was saddled with some annoying gimmick that I had to get used to. And the ground portion of the fight is boring anyway, and thankfully short-lived. You'll probably just have to block a few building chunks, because I guess Sora forgot that he's more than capable of slicing through those. I do wish that throwing Goofy into the top of his wind hole was an auto-win, though. This is another boss that bothers to put you in a non-mash-to-win condition, specifically when it forces Sora into a free-fall as the Titan uses his big leaf-blower arms to shoot debris at you. And then you make that satisfying, violent swan dive into his face thing. The anatomy of the Tornado Titan fascinates me. Must it always spin, or does it have a non-combat rest mode? How does it eat? Does it make love? I can probably find the answer to one of those, preferably in an incognito tab. Oh, how creative.
Wind!
Next is a KH3 boss fight that we're potentially the most well acquainted with, considering there exists footage of it that's older than my grandma. It's the Rock Titan. Maybe it's weird to have the first Titan battle in Olympus be ranked the highest, but I really like the build-up to this fight, and most importantly, when compared to the other game's early bosses, it's definitely one of the most fun to play. And unlike the Ice Titan, the Rock Titan is potentially the most improved boss since his last appearance. KH1 used him as a wet blanket of a finale to the Hades Cup where he could not pose less of a threat, Coded didn't happen, and look at him now. I'm not saying he's a real force to be reckoned with now, but considering he went down as easy as a tutorial boss in KH1, it only makes sense to literally relocate him to being a tutorial boss in KH3. He's also been buffed up a bit since he can now manifest rocks from nothing, which would have been useful while you pummeled on his two crusty heads during the Hades Cup. Plus, he's just way bigger, or at least feels that way, which is good given Sora's beefed up range and mobility. There are two major set pieces to the Rock Titan fight, the first of which is like the warm-up portion where you have to wall run up the mountainside and avoid the falling rocks. Of course, you can also take some time for yourself and do a bit of apple picking, there's no real rush. In the same way that the Tornado Titan introduces air stepping during combat, Rock Titan does the same for wall running, though there aren't as many opportunities to do that for a long stretch of time throughout the rest of the game. But this particular stretch is really fun and always felt pretty seamless. Of course, the fight is capped off, at least usually, with the Mountain Coaster Attraction Flow, the other major set piece for this encounter. I'm pretty middling on Attraction Flow in general. I definitely agree that they show up a bit too often and can trivialize certain fights, but when it's worked in as a semi-scripted part of the battle, I tend to like it a lot more, and it's cool to see the theme parks have some representation. Unfortunately, it only ever happens with the coaster, and the only other time is the Battle of a Thousand Bad Guys much later on. And it's a shame too, because, like I said, we started getting teased with this fight in 2013, so I had figured we'd get a bit more stuff like this in later fights. Although I could just as easily see myself being annoyed if they shoehorn things like this into every fight, but maybe two or three more could have been a nice balance. By the way, you can also fuck it up and not end the fight with the train like I did here. oops, bit anticlimactic.
No way!
We know you're annoyed that you didn't get Elsa as a party member, so here, take out your aggression on her newborn indentured servant. Conventionally, most people probably wouldn't put this battle super high, it's obviously not the headliner from Arendelle, but I've always enjoyed getting to fight against your party members. And in the past, while we fought Beast and Peter Pan, it was after they had already been in the player's party. But in this case, we get a prospective battle, and the reward is basically Marshmallow's loyalty for the rest of the level. Which, I did always think this battle came a bit late, since you really only have the snowstorm portion between this and the skull fight. I guess you can still free roam and do item collection with him tagging along after the fact, but his ass is too big for the labyrinth, so there goes half the world. It would have taken a bit of rearranging, but I wish we could have fought him right after coming out of the labyrinth for the first time, just so you get to enjoy the showcase of his strength for more of the world. But regardless, I like this idea of Sora conducting job interviews by way of ass-whooping. I hope this recruitment method sticks around for KH4. The fight itself is nothing mind-blowing, but it's home to one of very few reaction command-type moments in KH3, which features Sora and Goofy literally slapsticking Marshmallow in the face. Also, prior to this video, I never waited too long to miss my shot, so here's what that looks like if you were curious. Marshmallow really has two modes for this fight. As you can see here, this is the disinterest phase. And this is the tear you to fucking pieces phase. A death can seriously sneak up on you here, like, it's not a hard fight, but I found myself surprised by how quickly he can rack up the damage on you. Marshmallow also observes the Captain Hook tradition of being visibly upset when lit on fire, a lifestyle that I also follow.
You need to chill!
Sticking to Arendelle, let's talk about Skull.
Skull.
I'm not completely sure, but I get the vibe that this is one of the more well-regarded bosses in the game as far as popular sentiment goes, so it may be surprising that it's not higher up for me. Most conversation about Skull is with regards to its design and the more meaningful challenge it can provide. And I mean, I'm pretty much in lockstep with that praise. Critics are saying wolves are cool, and I am compelled to agree. Though I personally never got to experience the Skull sweet spot. I beat him first try on Standard and Proud, and then streamed myself fighting him for 4 hours on Critical Level 1. Maybe critical without restrictions is the happy medium for a challenging but not unforgiving Skull experience. That being said, I'm still trying to keep my white-hot rage separate from my ranking here. Skull is undeniably one of the most intimidating Heartless in the game, not only for its visuals, but the ferocity and speed of a lot of its attacks. I think it gets a lot of memorability points for its DM, and he's one of the few non-human things in KH3 with a notable desperation move. In his case, he starts a mini cutscene and a move called Dark Sun, and you essentially need to speedrun Majora's Mask to avoid getting hit by it. And nobody should die just for playing a game quickly, but the instructions here are kind of unclear, and that was one thing that always really bothered me about the fight. There were plenty of gimmick or switch-up segments like this in KH2, and the game was usually pretty clear on what you needed to do. Here, there's literally just a timer, and how exactly is that supposed to be informative of what I need to do? You're supposed to kill enough of these little wolf sperms in 40 seconds to trigger a situation command, but you can just as easily interpret this as, oh, I need to survive these wolf sperms for 40 seconds. Imagine dealing with Dance Water Dance and not knowing what the win condition is. It's hard enough as it is. But when you do get it right, and it can be a nail-biter even when well-equipped, you can start the Sub-Zero Impact command, in which Marshmallow will hold up the sun like Atlas, and Sora will spin his Keyblade on it until it fucking explodes, thus staving off the threat of an Ice Age. Which is good, because Disney does own Blue Sky now. Also, this wolf is Hans, by the way, or the darkness that was in his heart, or whatever. It's easy to forget, since Skull has more lines than him.
Freeze!
The word of this entry is catharsis. Like, remember that kid on the playground who snapped your toy in half, or called you Pat Dick instead of Patrick, using a clever twist of language? I'm not saying I endorse violence, but wouldn't it be at least a little neat to time travel and throw that kid from the top of the jungle gym and say, fuck you, George, and give me back my copy of Super Mario Strikers. I know you took that shit when I brought it to Jacob's sleepover. Also, when he called my mom a stripper on Yahoo Messenger, I told my mom, and she took it as a compliment, so really, you look like a big idiot, not very progressive of you, George! Anyway, it sure was nice to get the chance to beat the shit out of Vanitas. This fight is, like, purely exhibition. Unless you're doing a challenge run, I'm fairly confident that you're supposed to curb stomp this raspy voice twerp, and I'm more than happy to do it. It helps that by this point, if you played Birth by Sleep, you're more than familiar with Vanitas' kit, so there aren't a ton of surprises to look out for. And those fights, like all fucking 9 of them in that game, were a lot harder and our characters were much less agile. And I guess I buried the lead here, but we get to do this as Aqua, who is easily the person most deserving to deliver this beatdown. This one's for Neverland, you little prick! I will say, if you told me that we'd fight one member of the true organization prior to the graveyard, I don't think Vanitas would have been in the top half of my guesses. So it's kind of a weird outlier that this even happens, but I like it. A lot of KH3 pacing discourse seems to favor the idea of having this fight take place much earlier in the game, like maybe after Monstropolis or Arendelle, and I can't really disagree there. And I'm assuming, for the record, that the Unis Venetus door somehow ended up at Castle Oblivion and Venetus just waited around for someone to show up. It's kind of bullshit that after walking all over this guy, he still manages to get Aqua on the ropes in the cutscene after. But that's enough to wake up the sleeping piece of loose leaf behind her, and hooray, power awaking! You love it.
I'll let you have this one.
And believe it or not, we've arrived at the highest ranked Disney boss on the list, Davy Jones. I guess it's no surprise when there's so few competitors, but it is, unfortunately, a bit of a testament to how little KH3 bothered with Disney bosses. And I'm not saying it's an objective knock against the game, but for me, there was a lot of childlike wonder in battering Captain Hook or Jafar, and it's a shame that the younger generation have been deprived of that specific breed of violence. And say what you will, or even Elizabeth, about the Pirates franchise, but I always thought the original trilogy was fucking rad. Yeah, the third one was really long and sorta overly complicated, but I was really hyped to see the final showdown in the theater as a kid. So I was pretty happy with the sequence getting the KH treatment. And you know what, it's an improvement that the Kraken is present for both its own boss fight and during the Davy Jones battle, because they just killed it off between the second and third movies, and I always thought that was bizarre. In the fight itself, Jones isn't the toughest foe, he kinda takes a beating pretty easily on regular playthroughs, but it's more so the atmosphere of the fight that raises it this high for me. I love a good rainstorm, and we've never really had this type of aesthetic for a boss fight before. The closest thing is like the second dark side in KH1, but it's not even raining for that. While I find Davy Jones a bit lackluster when it comes to close quarters combat, I'm impressed by his ability to just, like, teleport around. I know he can phase through stuff, but I didn't know he was capable of just disappearing and manifesting somewhere else. And I think that's just part of his base kit. As far as I know, it's not like Scar, where he's got new abilities because he was corrupted by or turned into a Heartless.
I'm a Heartless.
Oh, I stand corrected. The fight is really only truly dangerous once he summons the Kraken, and shit can get crazy there. Let go of my dog, you slimy fuck! Jones also has a crazy attack where he glows blue and looks at you with disdain until you smack him. Really scary stuff. It's a shame Sora can only use his fist form change in cutscenes. I would have loved to use the Haymaker finisher on Davy Jones. Alright, we're now in the graveyard for something humanoid instead of title. And while a lot of these placements on the list were kind of amorphous and in flux when the project started, I always knew I'd have Dark Riku and Zigbar as the lowest organization fight. And it's not just for my aforementioned dislike for Dark Riku, but more so because this is like the island of misfit organization members. It lacks the synergy that pretty much every other graveyard encounter has. Like, Dark Riku and Zigbar have no real chemistry or history unless you count the little shoulder pad he gives him earlier on. And it's even more frustrating when you realize how easy of a fix it would be. Swap Dark Riku with Luxord, and you're killing two Chicken Littles with one stone because Luxord is the weirdo inclusion in his joint boss battle. You put Dark Riku with Larxene and Marluxia, the two Castle Oblivion traitors who try to use the Riku replica as their puppet. And having Luxord teamed up with Zigbar may have felt a bit weird in vanilla KH3, but Remind added that super tense cutscene between the two of them in Olympus, and you can reasonably assume that their paths might be intertwined moving forward. But even putting the future aside, they literally represent space and time, and those are like the chocolate and peanut butter of the cosmos. I digress, though I do wish I could have been in charge of the assigned seating here. As an actual fight, Dark Riku and Zigbar is actually pretty cool, since you've got the long-range attacker in Zigbar and the close combat guy in Dark Riku, and you can decide who you'd rather get out of the way first. Zigbar has an especially cool-looking DM with the aerial attack that gradually spreads out across the whole arena, even though it's much easier to deal with than his KH2 DM. And I've gotta say, Dark Riku's commentary really makes me wish KH3 had a Stopka spell that I could throw in his face.
I'm unstoppable!
Also, I probably should have established up top, but I'm sorta just fusing the Remind battles with the vanilla ones for the sake of the ranking. Some have minor gameplay changes like being able to play as Riku for this one, and some have gameplay and story changes like the Saix and Xion one, which we'll get to. Again, not gonna split hairs on each version, but obviously the option to play as Riku while fighting Riku will boost the Remind version to the definitive version of the battle. Not to mention the crazy scene afterwards, which Theater Mode calls Riku and Riku, where Riku jumps out of Riku to attack Riku after declaring that Riku is not Riku, but rather Riku. But god do I wish Repliku would have said take care of her when referring to Naminé, just to, you know, perfectly echo Riku's last line in KH1. And let's not let all of this distract from Zigbar, who's beaten so badly he throws himself off a cliff. But that's a little thing we call acting.
I'm done with you!
Maybe it was intentional that what I consider the weakest organization fights are the ones they put at the beginning of the gauntlet just to get them out of the way. Because once Sora finds himself in the labyrinth, he has the choice between Dark Riku and Zigbar or the next entry on our list, Larxene, Luxord, and Marluxia. As I already mentioned, the cohesion between the members here is not quite as strong as the ones we have left, but it edges out the last fight because at least Marley and Larxene are together for their Chain of Memories traitor synergy. Luxord is also here, and I mean, he at least uses cards. Everyone was throwing cards around in that castle. But that's a happy and stretchy coincidence, I think. And not only is Luxor the odd one out thematically, but also in the gameplay sense. Like, why is he so frail? He has 400 HP, the same amount as the tutorial Dark Side, and the next weakest member of the organization is young Xehanort with 1600. And he's just a baby, so it makes sense. Is he holding back? Did he forget his gimmick time meter in KH2? Does he know that I have a right analog stick and that this is not the craziest game to crack? I recall praising the Luxord fight in KH2 for how it encouraged active use of the camera, but I feel like his shuffling was a bit more complicated than forming a ring around the circular arena. Pick his card 3 times, he'll keel over, and then invite Sora to a poker game sometime when they're just guys being dudes. The wild card surely has implications for Sora's future, and one has to wonder if that table will get turned sometime in KH4. One also has to wonder if Luxor was trying to capture Mickey and keep him as a pet, but we may never know the answer to that. Also, and it's easy to forget, but Xemnas is actually hanging out here at the very start of the fight. A lot of these organization fights have a sort of false start where one character ends up leaving, or a character is invulnerable, or we're waiting for another character to show up. I found myself getting kind of fatigued by these instances. I'd prefer we just get all of that out of the way in the cutscene beforehand instead of being under this false impression that the battle has started. Especially if I manage to lose my Koopa coin in the fake fight. In this case, I don't know what Xemnas floating there adds, I don't know why he doesn't do what he ends up doing from the start. Anyway, he shoots some nothing strings into Luxor, which powers him up, something I wasn't aware he was capable of. Marluxia and Larxene are the true stars of the fight, and it was cool for Sora to have a battle with the two that he'll actually remember. Their attacks are fast and flashy, and in Remind, Sora and Mickey can respond with the Faith Volley RC, which allows you to shoot Orbeez at the two conspirators. Still, and I can only speak for myself, I only ever found one of these graveyard battles to be an actual challenge. And again, I don't necessarily use challenge or the lack thereof as a pro or con, but it's probably no surprise that harder bosses, ones that take more tries, might end up being more memorable. Because, you know, you see them longer. The fight, or rather the moment, is memorable on the merit of it being against organization members, but not so much for the fight itself, at least not for me. But, you know, in a sea of big dumb heartless, any occasion where I'm fighting against original characters in Sora's weight class will always do well, barring extenuating circumstances. Next up, we have the fight against the blue-haired young woman who's normally friendly, if a bit, yeah, so it's anti-Aqua for real this time. I feel like I've talked about anti-Aqua more than I thought I would in 2022, and definitely more than I wanted to, so I won't linger on this one for too long. Lingering won't. For me, the whole anti-Aqua experience is a bit tainted by how she was handled in the trailers. I'm not entirely out on the premise, I just don't like how she was built up to be something that she really wasn't. Because when you go into the game with this idea that Aqua is going to be this potential Xehanort vessel or even part of the true organization, that she may be a constant presence felt throughout the game, and then discover that she's sort of an afterthought in the actual game, it's easy to be disappointed. But in hindsight, it's still fun for what it is once you divorce it from the preconceived notions. While the definitive fight against an evil Aqua is still probably the 0.2 Zodiac Mirror Aqua, this one is obviously superior as far as story stakes are concerned. For me, it really harkened back to the Riku Ansem fight in KH1. Obviously, Sora lacks the personal connection with Aqua, but this isn't the first time he's fought one of our heroes while they were under the influence of darkness. And darkness is a hell of a drug, just a year or 11, and the next thing you know, you're dancing under the bridge with the Cybergoth kids. I do like her design overall, though, and a lot has been made about her similarities to the Darklings, and I won't speak on that because I don't have the necessary degree to discuss Union Cross. The fight pulls from a lot of the 0.2 version's tricks between evil Spellweaver ice skating and cloning herself while muttering about her insecurities and complaining, which is my most coveted Kingdom Hearts ability. My dream job distance streams would be so much more efficient if multiple Miis could complain at the same time. We also get my preferred rendition of Aqua's theme, Aqua Dark Dive, a dramatic and mournful piece that thankfully cannot be interrupted by Hand in Hand as Sora smacks Aqua in the face with a lit-up pirate ship. I guess they truly couldn't resist the urge to let you use the water move against the water girl in the water prison. Even still, the fight managed to catch me off guard a bit on my first playthrough, and I found it to be an occasion where you really should try to block instead of just run around and tank hits, which was kind of what I was able to do for most of the game. And once the fight is over, we get another huge emotional payoff in Aqua returning to the Realm of Light. The fact that her first inclination was to assume Destiny Islands fell into darkness instead of realizing she had finally escaped goes to show how resigned she was to her fate. And we were able to save her, with violence. Kingdom Hearts 3, just beat the depression out of your friends. Don't do that, please.
Aqua!
The Kingdom Hearts series has a rich history of secret bosses. Unknown, Lingering Will, Motherfucker, and now this rollerblading invisible with two swords. I'll be honest, I did not think highly of Dark Inferno the first time I played the game, and headed into this project, I anticipated he'd be far outside the top 20. Because what or who is he, and why should I care? I know we have Remind now, and Yozora is now what we more immediately think of when we hear KH3 Secret or Super Boss, but this was what we had for a year. And sure, those bosses I listed before were Final Mix exclusives, but even taking the vanilla releases into account, there were still optional and much stronger bosses like Sephiroth to test your skills against. And the common trait between all of those bosses is that they either explicitly hinted toward the next game, or in Sephiroth's case, was a recognizable and powerful figure from a different game. But Dark Inferno, it felt like you weren't really getting either of those things. Outside of a little bit of chatter about his design, it seemed as if this boss just showed up with no lore attached, not even a cutscene before or after its battle. Maybe he is hinting toward a future game implicitly, and maybe this fight will be much cooler in hindsight, but I'm more inclined to take it for what it appears to be, which is just a strong Heartless. A scarf doesn't really hit the same as a full-blown speech. Now, the Remind Dark Inferno might be a different story, but of course, that fight is a cakewalk compared to the base game fight. And it also just raises questions and confusion, and not really in the fun way, at least in my opinion. Because this is Dark Inferno X, or Kai, the meaning is the same. It's the form that capital D Darkness takes when Sora is rummaging about Ven's heart. This one looks different and goes by a different name, so does that mean it's truly a separate entity from the one we fight in the base game? I don't know, I'm just sort of annoyed by the idea that the inferior version is the one that could potentially have story significance. I'd prefer a marriage of the story implications and the tougher gameplay, and the latter half of that is why I have the Inferno this high. Again, toughness does not equal quality for me, but it can equal more fun, and that does matter. Unfortunately, on my first playthrough of the game, I did all of the previous battle gates and got Ultima Weapon before fighting Dark Inferno, and it was just an utterly unnoteworthy first try pushover. But on the file I used to get footage for this video, even on standard, getting to the endgame with my level in the late 20s and not having Ultima Weapon, Dark Inferno was legitimately a fun fight to learn. I sort of dismissed him earlier as a rollerblading invisible with two swords, but like, a rollerblading invisible with two swords is still a monstrous and ferocious physical presence. The speed and range of his attacks and his ability to close distance so quickly makes him truly terrifying. At least when you're not armed to the teeth and roided up on cold tomato soup and stuffed quail, and yes, I chose those two cuisines because I could pronounce them. Dark Inferno's fighting style basically demands that you play on his level, to be as quick and precise and to close the distance and make the most of your openings by way of air stepping or whatever other means necessary. One thing I really appreciate about the Dark Inferno is how he doesn't exactly add a bunch of new shit once you reach some arbitrary point in his HP bar. He's pretty much doing all of his attacks from the start, and he does enter new phases, but he starts chaining shit together and the power of those attacks are a bit beefed up. You still have to get used to it and learn it, but it feels less like this demoralizing wall that you might hit with other bosses, where you master their first phase and then they just completely flip the Monopoly board and start doing completely new shit that's borderline unreactable the first time through. I really wish I hadn't saved Dark Inferno for absolute last on my first playthrough, because I figured, well, if I make Ultima Weapon after that, what am I gonna use it for? It turned what could have been an intricate and fast-paced battle into a pretty thoughtless slugging match. But my opinion of him definitely raised through doing this project, even if I'm still left feeling underwhelmed by it on the story side.
Make me work!
And kicking off our top 10 is another graveyard fight. It's Terra Xehanort and Vanitas. To start, I may have this fight higher than most because I think I tend to like Birth by Sleep more than the average bear, so the story stakes and character work here appeals a lot more to me than the nuts and bolts of the gameplay. And obviously, of the organization fights we've covered so far, this one has the best pairing of opponents. Aqua and Ven are also more cohesive party members here than Mickey was in the last fight, since, you know, they all used to hang out. Really nice to have the gang back together again. Remember last time we were all here? Everyone's up to their old tricks again. Vanitas is surfing on the weapons of dead children. Terranort is saying the same battle quotes over and over. It's great. Remind also improves this fight a bit by giving you the chance to partake as Aqua, and again letting you stomp on two bosses who were notoriously shitheads to deal with in BBS. Not to mention, we get a team-up attack with Ven in which he gives you the options of skate or die. By the way, this is why Sora and Roxas are good at skateboarding. It's a trait inherited through Ven, who also rides his glider that way. That's not actually canon or anything, I think it's neat. I'm also just now noticing that Aqua's portrait when she's in critical health is the exact face I made after pouring 3 hours into the Terranort fight in Radiant Garden back in Birth by Sleep. Like the other fights in the graveyard so far, this one is pretty much over before you know it, but we're rewarded with some pretty fun scenes of our opponent's supposed deaths. After Vanitas asserts his brotherhood with Ven for the 90th time, the latter finally accepts that he is not making progress with this lunatic and basically just gives up to Sora's chagrin. But the real story here is the Terranort defeat scene, featuring Terra's triumphant return and escape from the Guardian, which gets me so goddamn hyped every time I see it. What a fun fucking twist. The Guardian going AWOL, the music, Terra repeating his promise, it's all just so good. I also feel like this scene is the first time KH3 is actively trying to make us cry. I managed to hold out until the very end of the game, but they didn't make it easy. Also, there is a solo Terranort fight in Remind, but I don't care about it, and neither do you.
Ven! Aqua!
I have a couple of bosses on each of these lists that are admittedly perhaps too high, your Phantoms or Hydras, but wouldn't these videos be kind of boring if I didn't put something like the Grim Guardianess above a bunch of the graveyard fights? And to be clear, I don't just put things high up arbitrarily or to troll, I genuinely do think there's a lot of merit and good stuff there. This Mother Gothel tree zombie is indeed my favorite Heartless boss in the game and my favorite boss outside of the endgame. It's nothing really to do with this design, like it's a tree thing, and sure, there's a bunch of forests in the Kingdom of COVID, but I don't really associate that with Mother Gothel. I guess they both have big hair. But the real strength of this fight, for me, lies in the environment. I am absolutely entranced by a boss arena like this. Not only is the terrain totally unlike anything else in the game, complete with hills, ledges, and a big-ass tower, but it's also centered around an iconic location from the movie. Nothing ever feels in the way, but it also feels like your positioning matters, and the way you approach the fight might change depending on where the battle takes you. And I just really like the variety of her attacks. She's the only boss to cast Burdaga on you. She headbutts the dirt and makes you sneeze. She has a distinct DM-like move where she puts you in vine prison and you have to do this little game of finding the opening while she drops rotten fruit on you. And then you get this great wall-running moment up the tower to knock her off. Eventually she throws in these flowers that keep you trapped nearby if you get too close to them until they're destroyed. I feel like there aren't a ton of bosses in the game that change up the rules of engagement but also don't feel unfair or annoying. Like, I feel like I can just wail on the King of Toys or Big Fish and never really have enough time to notice what they're doing. Sure, they'll attack and I need to dodge or block, and that applies to the Guardianess too, but I just appreciate how she throws in a few extra elements to spice things up. Partner that with a distinct location to fight in, and it was an early spot for my top 10.
Achoo!
So, as I mentioned, the rest of these fights are all late-game graveyard and Scala stuff. For number 8, we're going back to another organization fight, this time with Syax and Shion, and throw Xemnas in for the remind version of the battle. I've long said that my favorite of the trios is the Daze crew, and it's really not even close. I'm not even a huge Daze guy, but I just feel like I know these three and their friendship more than SRK and certainly the Wayfinder trio. And obviously, this fight's emotional core is the relationship between all of these estranged co-workers. This fight was truly a sight to behold the first time through. Getting past the stop and start shit at the beginning, which I already established I don't care for, this whole thing is basically just the flogging of Syax. And it's very much deserved. Like, I know he apologized, but he really was such a dick. He's the textbook definition of getting to a middle management position and then becoming the worst person you've ever met. And I hate to talk about definitions in front of him because he doesn't know what motivation means, fucking blueberry douchebag. And the best part of all is that the optimal strategy is to stay the fuck out of it and let Roxas absolutely slaughter this guy. The amount of damage he can do on his own is criminal, and I'm completely fine with it. Sora already got his end back in KH2. I am putting my hands up and looking the other way while Roxas and Shion feed this bitch his own hair. And obviously this is even better in Remind when you get to do the thrashing yourself, but I was still satisfied to sit back and watch the show in the base game. It's truly a marvel to see Syax's HP plummet even in spite of his moon tantrums. I sort of brushed past the earlier portion of the fight, but is there a reason why Shion opts to use the claymore for a bit? Sometimes I can't even tell who's who because they're both just whipping around making moon waves like crazy. Of course, the Remind fight that adds Xemnas into the fray also adds this absolutely fucking ridiculous team attack where the Sea Salt trio does everything imaginable to Xemnas short of putting him up on the fucking cross. And I'm just yelling the whole time this is going down. This enthusiasm also applies to the cutscenes on either end of this battle, which is filled to the brim with amazing moments. Shion defecting thanks to Syax using the sleeper cell trigger words, Axel's fourth wall moment, Xemnas's subsequent attempted murder of Axel, Roxas's light show of revival, the game once again trying to yank the tears out of my eyeballs with the trio's hug at the end. It's, again, more about the spectacle and story here for me, but it was such a wild ride both times through, and parts of it still give me chills rewatching or replaying it now.
Roxas!
The way my jaw dropped when Xehanort puts on the mask of a goat and cements that he's the fucking devil. At this point, I'm still swept up in the grandeur of Scala ad Kylum, the stairway to heaven, and we'll get more into that later, but then Xehanort throws a Bible at my head and turns the world upside down. I'm trying to contemplate what this could do with the six characters named after deadly sins while engaged with the boss who by far took the most attempts on my first playthrough. Between the three phases, the old goat took 18 stocks off of me, like it was getting dire. I'll get the negative out of the way. I really don't care for the underwater portion, mostly because it throws you back into this control scheme that you probably haven't used in like 5 or 6 hours. And I don't even really dislike it, I just take a while to reacclimate. I just wish there could have been some portion of explorable Scala in the base game and have a segment of that where you have to explore underwater before the boss fight and get the hang of the controls again. Honestly, I think the worst part was the series of explosion moves that he'll use partway through that second phase. I kept trying to dodge them and had a lot of trouble when in reality blocking probably would have been the easier and safer move. But it's kind of a nitpick, and it was wise for them to put the worst part in the middle. That's what I did for this video. As a whole, I love that the fight goes from land to sea to sky. Those three things kind of have a history in the series. And thank God the game has the good sense to start you from the beginning of each phase if you die instead of back at square one. Plus, the atmosphere of this fight is top-notch. The Scala Inception hallway for Part 1, the Daybreak Town ruins for Part 2, and the completely trashed streets of Scala for Part 3. Odin is gonna be mad when he gets back from his big vacation. And Xehanort's moves here really do invoke this straight-from-hell feeling, what with the burning pillars and orbs, and it's straight-up terrifying when he charges out from the flames in the center of the stage. Also, I think Armored Xehanort is the first boss to just chokeslam Sora. Is that allowed? He loves choking people. I do think this fight is more mechanically interesting than the true final Xehanort fight, and I like how it's a 1v1 between him and Sora for the final part, but the following fight has just a bit more juice behind it for me.
More, you say?
So let's talk about that fight, Keyblade or Kaiblade Xehanort. Of my list for the mainline games, he is the lowest of the final bosses, though I think I do prefer him over Final Ansem in KH1. This one feels like more of a true finale to the game, but I'd still have KH2 Xemnas over it, at least as a standalone finale for that singular game. But I'm pretty happy with how KH3 and the Xehanort saga closes out. I like how we have SDG as the final party again, I like the atmosphere, I like Xehanort's attacks, and there's also music playing. There sure is. Part of me wishes things were swapped, that Armored Xehanort was last, because he's a lot more intimidating than veiny, bald-headed old man Nort. You could conceivably have this fight, but with Xehanort wielding no name, and then follow it up with Armor Nort using the Keyblade. But I also think having it be frail Geriatra Nort helps illustrate the power of the Keyblade. Because remember, the whole reason this dude possessed Terra was because he was worried about dying soon, so it's not like he's in his physical prime, and he's still able to do all this crazy shit. The first half of the fight is admittedly nothing special. Xehanort sort of just floats around, pops out of keyholes, and uses simple slash attacks. He does have this move of Zaw level spells too, and I'm just glad Ven is out of Sora's heart at this point so he doesn't have to put up with being made into a popsicle again by this old fuck. It's about halfway into his HP when the true battle starts, when the screen flashes white and Grandpa literally summons Kingdom Hearts in the middle of the fight. Now we're fighting on the world's largest and most expensive doily, and Xehanort starts to add in some new moves. He'll start throwing in some dark meteors, and thankfully he maintains an interest in slashing at Donald and Goofy, who are usually confined to the ground while you put on an air show with Xehanort 100 feet in the air. The truly crazy shit happens when he's lost about 11 bars when he sends Sora into a forced rage form, minus the ability to revert or use Risk Charge, aka it sucks. I mean, thematically it's cool, I'm not sure if it's gonna have any broader lore implications, but it speaks a lot of Xehanort's or the Keyblade's power that he can just drain all of the light out of someone. I guess my biggest gripe is I wish there was some kind of bar that shows how much more you have to attack Xehanort in order to get back to normal. It's better than the skull thing because it at least gives you the basic instruction of attacking him, but I think the first time through I didn't even realize that he was dropping little light balls. Which, thankfully, heal you as well, I feel like I didn't notice that either. It's still a cool changeup, I just felt that the Riku moment in KH2 was a bit more clear or self-explanatory. And throwing something like that in a fight, especially late in it, is a risky move because it can feel cheap if the rules are changed and the player is, like, unsure on what to do. But once Sora gets his light back, you can initiate a move that would have ended up being one of my profile pictures or backgrounds if I was still in middle school. Xehanort counters with this terrifying fucking blood council of pissed off organization clones. Seems like Sora is finally being put on trial for his various murders, complete with a remodeled round room emblazoned with a goat head. This move is relentless, and it obliterated me my first time. And my second, third, fourth, and fifth times. And I just needed to know how the game ended, so I meow-wowed through that shit. Once you get his HP depleted, the game decides, well, we trolled him at the beginning with the 2.9 thing, it might as well be symmetrical, and slaps you with the fake-out death. I legitimately thought I blinked and missed a prompt or something, and was so pissed. But god, this is so good. You're mashing buttons or flicking the sticks, and you hear Donald and Goofy yelling for Sora. Bonus points if you're playing on PS4, where it comes through the controller. And who wouldn't get a second win from that? Sora bounces back and turns my friends or my power into a concentrated beam of fuck you energy. Gotta say, I wish Ansem would have gotten key beamed at some point in KH1 because it would have made for a nice trilogy of final blows throughout the games. And with that, Xehanort is defeated and his saga is finally over. Dark Road would release 17 months later.
Light!
And a year later, he'd also get another unique boss fight in Remind. Going into the project, I didn't anticipate having the Remind Armor Nort as the highest Xehanort battle, but upon playing it again, I was really impressed with it. While Replica Armored Xehanort, or Rax, is almost visually the same as his appearance in the three-part fight in the base game, this new final boss adds in enough that really elevates it for me. Obviously, the headline here is the ability to play as Kairi. I think by KH3, it was high time Sora got to fight alongside her, and while we got that in the base game with the Saix and Shion fight, it's so short-lived I wouldn't blame you if you forgot. But not only is she presented as an equal to Sora in this fight, but we finally get the chance to play as her. She's been the princess who was promised since she picked up Destiny's Embrace in 2005. The games still have a lot of work to do when it comes to Kairi, if you ask me and most others, but this is easily a top 3 moment for her across 20 years of games. And I don't really know how people feel about it, but I really enjoy how she plays. Like, sure, it's not as snappy, and Merlin apparently didn't teach her how to set her shortcuts properly either, but it really felt like a fusion of Sora and Aqua to me. Her combos feel feisty and improvised, but elegant at the same time, and I love that sort of strike-raid air-stepping combination she does to close the distance. I hope if she's playable in future games that it stays part of her basic kit. Her shotlock is awesome, and after the game is all said and done, I think Kairi will definitely believe Sora's claim that he once flew. On top of all of that, she's got a killer situation gauge move, and her team-up attack with Sora allows you to throw the Bible right back in Xehanort's face. This is the true biblically accurate angel. And the attack has insane details that I didn't even know until reading up on it on the KH Wiki, but all of the feathers have different memories from the games on them, with one of 4 iconic Sora and Kairi moments appearing on the big feather at the end. The only thing I don't like about playable Kairi here is her "please work" battle quote, because the Kairi I grew up with would be 100% confident that this shit would work. KH1 Kairi would have said, "Nothing will work more than this is about to, you fucking lazy bum," before ripping off Xehanort's goat mask, eating it, and spitting out the horns. But above all of that, what really sold me on this fight is how absolutely insane some of these visuals are. Those 12 extra no-names are really putting in work here because Xehanort pulls off some gnarly shit. Like, this fight is just filled with stunning imagery. Get rid of the HUD and change up the camera angles a bit, and it looks like it came out of an opening FMV. There's just something completely bonkers about running around as Kairi while a bunch of meteors plunge into the arena and generate mushroom cloud explosions. I mean, look at these silhouettes of Kairi and Xehanort slashing at each other in Satan's backyard. I played the DLC by myself, but I distinctly remember audibly reacting to what I was seeing several times. In short, more of this from Kairi in the future, please. I don't know what she needs more training for, it seems like she cleaned the fuck up here, but I digress.
Kairi!
Outside of, like, the Kraken, this is the most gimmicky fight on the list, but it's too good to be down that low. Sticking to Remind, it's the battle that immediately precedes Kairi v Xehanort, it's Guardians of Light v Replicas. And I know what you're saying, it's hardly even a fight, you're not even controlling one character, but again, health bar, special music, I say it counts. I think I've used this phrase before in another video, but for me, this fight is what I call a school notebook moment. As in, why did I get a 64 on my pre-algebra quiz? Because I was drawing this fucking battle in my notebook during class. This fight just captured that childlike wonder, that anticipatory, nervous energy you had while waiting, dreaming about this game, boiled down and concentrated into a hot ball of fan service. Riku, Mickey, Roxas, Axel, Shion, Terra, Aqua, Ven, and you get to play as all of them. I mean, holy shit. Sure, you're all floating in a big friend tornado and it's not like a traditional boss fight, but without designing playstyles for another handful of characters and somehow giving them all their own battles, this was more than worthy compromise if you ask me. It's a mash fest, but it's not like we've never seen that before in the other games, and there's still a degree of strategy and timing involved when you have to use Reflect. The prodigal son returns. The team-up attacks are beautiful, the banter is great and felt sorely needed after the lack of base game scenes of these characters interacting, and it feels like everyone got some time to shine. There's like too much to cover, so I'll just pick out some highlights. The Riku and Terra team-up RC being called Successor, Axel patting himself on the back and being scolded by Aqua, Jesse McCartney saying to Jesse McCartney, "Good job, Jesse McCartney," and Jesse McCartney replying, "Thanks, Jesse McCartney." I don't need KH4, I've already got an IV, and it's filled with that good KH shit going directly into my veins. The one bad part of this is that it's too hard to hear everyone, especially Terra, but that basically just made me want to play the fight again and listen more closely. And by the way, I didn't even factor Mickey's Metal Gear 4 microwave hallway crawl into this fight's placement, and you know what? If I did, it would have been just a bit higher. I decided against it just because there's no HP bar on the enemies there and you literally can't die, he refuses to die, and you may have noticed, I've called him Mickey several times throughout this video, because I played this part again, and I don't know if it's just the holiday season making me a bit soft, but God damn it, I'm sorry, Mickey. You died for our sins, you fucking chumbawumba the replicas, you got knocked down, and you got back up again. I was wrong. You didn't leave her there for 10 years. We've had our differences about other things, but I can look past them. Bring it in, you big-eared bastard. If some of our main heroes didn't get character development throughout this game, at least I did.
Your Majesty!
Yo, Zora! What an absolute menace. Do you know how demoralizing it is to slog through 13 data organization fights, to think you finally conquered Remind after a long night, only to be greeted by the sweet life of Zack and bullshit? Throughout my run here on YouTube, I've never hidden how I have trepidations about the Virum Rex or Quadratum stuff introduced in KH3. When I first saw the secret ending in the base game, I was honestly annoyed that the fake video game commercial from Toybox was also somehow going to factor into the main plot in what seems like a major way. To be honest, I'm still sort of put off by it, but I've gradually opened up to the idea. I'm willing to see where it goes. And given how I complained that Dark Inferno lacked that lore spice I want in a super boss, I'm more than glad that Yzora is here to deliver. Or rather, take, because ding dong, it's me, I'm the delivery boy. Sora needs to get this Keyblade insured, or at least give it a talking to, because it clearly has zero loyalty. I'm convinced it left Jack Sparrow not because it's bound to Sora, but because Jack just smells that bad. I've ranked both Yzora and Lingering Will at number 3 on their respective lists. They're both battles against characters from secret endings, and given my higher level of intrigue and enthusiasm for what would become Birth by Sleep, I would rank Lingering Will higher in the story department, at least for now. But as a fight, I have to put Yzora ahead. There is no crueler, more soul-crushing, more mind-fucky battle in the series than the fight against Heterochromatic Noctis atop the 104 building. So kind of them to mark the establishment with a lowball estimate of how many times you will perish. On the outside, I'm trying to be strong. On the inside, I'm in the fetal position in the seaside shack. Yzora is so brutally difficult, the first time I fought him, I thought it was all purely for show, that it was scripted that he would run up to me, steal my Keyblade, and dispatch me like I'm a minor inconvenience to him. Like, oh haha, it's just a teaser, it's one of those KH moments where you play for a little bit and then the story picks back up. And then, it said I could retry. So began a training montage for the ages, filled with laser enemas, Doritos of Doom, and me saying the fuck word a whole bunch of times.
Thought you'd win?
No, I really very didn't, thanks so much, Dylan. This fight is just the ultimate test of your skills, and it smacks you in the face after a conga line of what you thought were the final exams. Those were warm-ups. As much as I seethed while throwing myself at this battle, it really is so fun to learn and beyond satisfying to pull off. And ultimately, it felt fair. I hold a bit of a grudge against it since the game conditioned me into thinking red attacks had to be dodged when in fact they're now the only things you can block here. Now blue is the anti-block color, it's just another way the fight fucks with you. And that's not even the worst of it, this kid is a kleptomaniac. I've joked in the past about boss characters appropriating protagonist behaviors of healing in the middle of a fight, but this fucker takes it to a whole new level. He'll siphon your HP, sure, but who does it this day and age? How about taking your items? How about taking and using your Koopa coin? Thank God the theft is easy enough to avoid, because if he was just a bit quicker and less transparent about when he would snatch that from you, it wouldn't be worth bringing to the fight. Yzora by far has more moves than any other boss in the game, and possibly the series, I would think only Lingering Will could come close. And not even William would dare to start off his fight with his DM. A circumstance that, while rare, once again makes you question if that's even supposed to happen. I remember it happening on like my third or fourth attempt and I was like, is this a glitch? After a few hours of grinding the fight, you'll find yourself begging for certain moves even though every single one killed you all the same for your first handful of attempts. Everyone has the ones they eventually get good at and the ones that they never got the hang of. Unless you're a freak of nature who's just clowning on this guy effortlessly, in which case feel free to announce yourself so we can all line up, get on our knees, and get the video demonetized. The battle is a marathon, a war of attrition like no other that I can remember in this series, and the pure, unbridled dopamine that your brain explodes with once you get the job done is unparalleled. Can't wait for when he's a party member in KH4 and he suddenly ain't shit anymore.
You're done.
No, I didn't forget about the base game replicas fight, I really do have it this high, and I know it's too high, but it's an entirely emotional response. The Remind fight against the replicas tapped into that childlike sense of imagination, and I think this fight tapped into something similar, but darker. After thinking about it a bit, I think it was fear, or at the very least an uneasy, unsettled feeling. The KH3 endgame took me back to being a kid several times and in several different ways. I was entranced by the final world, I fanboyed over the graveyard fights, and walking into Scala for the first time felt like that magic of the initial drop into Rising Falls back in KH1. Maybe that wonder was diminished for people who are more cognizant of trailers, but this place was brand new to me when I first played KH3. So, admittedly, the splendor of the location is doing some favors for this fight since the battle kicks off not more than 20 seconds after you first show up. I've heard this discussed before, but it can't be overstated how cool and sort of unusual it is to have this white, brightly colored area serve as the backdrop for the final stretch of the game. The finales to every other game in the series are set in these dark, decrepit, or bleak places, and this is clearly a shakeup to the formula. It's almost more unsettling this way, it's this pristine city frozen in time, but something is so immediately, obviously, and deeply wrong. I feel like I'm starting to cut in on the inevitable KH3 world ranking script, so I'll move away from the set and onto the actors. Here enters the contrast to these bright city streets in the Stairway to Heaven. I played this game in my early 20s, and I'm sorry, the replica Xehanorts are fucking scary. Like, they're obviously not hide behind the couch and turn the game off scary, but they're upsetting, they don't really feel like anything I've known from these games. That's what the series has always been about, the contrast and juxtaposition of finny fun and self-sacrifice. It's that strand of DNA further twisted into something that feels wrong. I don't know if it's just a heebie-jeebie for me and if this is just nonsense to everyone else, but they just creep me out. The first time through, I remember tilting my head, squinting to get a better look at them, and saying, "What the fuck?" They make no noise, they float lifelessly in a big circle, they just feel otherworldly or other-gamely. I think a lot of that initial unease comes from the fact that it wasn't 100% clear what they even were. Without the secret reports, all you're really given is mysterious adversaries. I don't dislike that they're really just replica bodies from Vexen's experiments, but I do think I preferred knowing a bit less about what we were dealing with here. Even still, it's sort of unnerving to think that these 12 replicas were, as described in the reports, failures and then revisited and tinkered with and turned into this. I don't even know what I thought they were the first time. They're obviously all carrying the same weapons held by the true organization, and we just killed most of them, so I don't know, I was like, are these their souls trapped in these cloaks and helmets? Shion's kingdom key is there, so obviously it makes even less sense that way, but my brain was going a mile a minute. But it wasn't just the replica's appearance or the mystery around them that truly spooked my bones, it was also just how the battle plays out. There's really nothing else in this series quite like it. In the cutscene beforehand, they all ascend out of nowhere, surround the party, and just disappear. And they're gone. And you're standing there. And then it occurs to you that they're still here, they're just lying in wait. Edge of Existence is thumping away, you start exploring the city, when suddenly the camera pulls in on a cluster of them who just blipped into the sky, and the track called Replicas kicks in, and now you're in the fight for your life. You fend them off, they disappear again, and the cycle repeats. I've definitely gotten better at fighting them since my first playthrough, during which it took me about 7 tries, but even still, they can just gang up on you and snipe you from off-screen, it's incredibly hectic. On top of all of that, their DM may as well be called Eternal Damnation. I mean, look at this fucking thing. The sky turns into a Virtual Boy game as hellfire rains down from above and the replicas charge into you, gradually adding more members to the attack. Thankfully, once you realize they all share one health bar, you can devastate their HP with stuff like Aroga or a team-up attack. It's also probably no surprise that I'm a sucker for the environment, not just visually, but structurally too. I love jumping between the rooftops and bouncing off the walls and ducking behind corners to heal or reposition before taking the fight back to one of the replicas. I don't know, folks. Again, I know it's really, really high, but I have to reward it for how it made me feel. It's just one for my personal books.
What was that?
How do you give the number one spot to anything besides the trifecta of Edge, the Brotherhood of Brooding, the affectionately fan-named Nortquart? It's another doodle in the notebook moment, three of our heroes facing off against three of the major villains, the derivatives of the big man himself, who's actually there on top of his little murder tower, tossing around keyblades and making quips. I know I just made amends with Mickey, but I do wish it was Kyrie here as the third member instead, and you don't even have to change the story, just have her get wrist-grabbed right after this, if you must. That aside, while fights like Yzora may be mechanically deeper or remind Xehanort a bit flashier, for me, they can't stack up against the history surging through the battlefield here, the feeling of an era coming to a close. True rematches for the ages, with titans of the series being represented. Cage 1, Cage 2, BBS in the background. Just speaking from my own experience, the Nortquart was the only graveyard fight that provided any sort of resistance and had the best marriage of catharsis and challenge. It took me a few tries, but I was kinda glad it did, because I just wanted to simmer in this moment for more than the usual 2 to 3 minutes these fights had been taking. It's sort of like a fanfiction page come to life, you just wanna marinate in it for a bit. While the individual members of the court aren't as strong as they are as final bosses in their original games, they're still a force to be reckoned with. Which I'd hope they would be, because I would think it'd be a lot easier to nail the choreography when you're teaming up with yourselves. The fight starts off as the usual free-for-all, but the Nort boys quickly realize, hey, if Yzora can just kick shit off with the DM, we can too, and they launch into a synchronized, well-oiled machine of an attack only after launching Riku and Mickey to God knows where. And once the dust clears from all of the Keyblades, everyone's back on the scene and it is just mayhem. Young Xehanort is swinging that goddamn whip around, Xemnas is still practicing for his ballet recital, and Ansem has serious issues respecting personal space. Normally I'm bored by the flat arenas, but you really need the room here, because everyone is doing their own thing now and you're gonna appreciate the breathing room. I suppose it's kind of weird that the fight technically gets easier as it goes on, which is usually the opposite of how these things go. You're taking pieces off the board, and anyone who was caught in the crossfire along the way will retain their damage. It's really just getting over the initial hump that can be tricky, but maybe that's fine. That's the challenge part. The rest is exhibition. I like to go in reverse chronological order if I can help it, taking out young Xehanort first because he's, to put it politely, a punk-ass little bitch baby. And the first time, I was just paranoid that if I saved him for last, he might try to stop time and bring the other two back. Then I take out Xemnas, and then Ansem last, since it really all began with him. I've talked about the death scenes before, but god do I love this group's parting words. Ansem and Xemnas wax poetic about the past, and young Xehanort, ever true to his time-traveling nature, hints at Sora's future. Sora's incredulous what is legitimately top-tier delivery by HJO.
What?
Xemnas has been a messy bitch his entire life, or multiple lives or whatever, and the moment he realizes he may actually feel something for all of the people he manipulated, he fades away, this time for good. And on his way out, he acknowledges the Herculean strength it requires to merely exist as a human being. And I can talk at length about Ansem's parting words, in fact I did in that top 10 scenes video. The original bad guy, the one who first shook my very soul in the secret place in 2002, encourages Sora and Riku to move on, to continue to broaden their horizons. I've always said that it felt like he was talking directly to us, the players. Little did I know, nearly 4 years later, my amazing patrons would chip in to get me a video message from the man himself for my birthday, and here he was, literally speaking directly to me, rattling off quotes from this very scene, not even by prompt, just by luck.
Hello, Pat. It is I, Ansem of Kingdom Hearts. Wishing you a very, very happy birthday, my friend.
And what a full circle sort of thing, you know? Like, here's my favorite boss in this game that reignited my love for the series and ultimately pushed me to take a stab at this whole YouTube thing. Something under, like, 600 people knew about the channel until I did that first boss ranking, and somehow we're 2 years out from that, taking our third swing at this exercise. I could never have anticipated that I'd get to meet so many incredible, caring, and insanely generous and supportive people through this whole thing. Much less that a bunch of them would get together and plot to get Richard Epcar to sing me happy birthday. And yeah, I love this fight, I love these scenes, I love these games, and I love talking about them for way too long. Just thought I'd follow the game's lead and do a bit of reminiscing and bookending here. There's certainly more to seek though, and I hope you'll join me in that pursuit. That's another one for the books. If you enjoyed, I would greatly appreciate if you'd leave a like, subscribe if you're interested in new stuff from me, and if you're really, really into it, you can check out that Patreon. As I stated at the top, we have a goal, so if we meet that, I got some bangers I'm ready to put out. I know most people leave after the jingle, so this part is just for people who are interested in me or anyone who has me playing out of reach, I guess. As I mentioned, I usually do these videos like right around Christmas, like I did the first one the day of and then the second one the day after, and I do intend to kind of take it easier during the holidays this year. Doesn't mean there won't be anything else from me in 2022. Might have some smaller projects here and there in December, but I think this will be the last like real big boy for the year. And I don't anticipate that I'll be like hopping on the mic like this in whatever I may end up doing in December. So just wanted to say thank you for another amazing year. Really, it topped 2021, and I didn't think that was possible. I've just been really happy with how things are going, and I want nothing more than to continue it into 2023. I know that I can be and get better at what I do. I've never been like a big New Year's resolution guy, but I think this next year I want to be even better and more cognizant of how I do business, make content, and conduct myself throughout the internet. I want to be better with how I engage with people. I don't know how to frame it as like not a bragging thing, but I get so many positive comments, and I don't respond to nearly as many of those as I do to negative ones. And I really want to fix that about myself, because it's really like, you know, 2 out of 100 that'll be like that. And it really shouldn't, but it sticks in your craw, and it's just stupid to let that kind of stuff piss me off and be provoked into, you know, being negative towards other people. Because at the end of the day, I'm always torn between, like, it's just YouTube videos, but it's also, like, what I'm doing for a living. So it's hard not to take it seriously, even though we're inherently dealing with pretty unserious stuff. I'm not sure what the whole point of this was, but I just wanted to say thank you. Thank you for sticking around. Hopefully you'll stick around into next year, where I plan on being and doing better and being the best me that I can be on the Regular Pat YouTube channel. Until next time, be safe out there. Happy holidays, and I'll see you soon. Bye.
You're just starting out, my friend. Enjoy your life. Be happy. All the best,